SVM Asset Management's Neil Veitch, fund manager of the UK Opportunities Fund, has been at the helm of that particular fund now for 7 years. And this is a period, of course, where we've seen wide swings in pricing and, of course, also opportunities within the equity space. Let's talk now to Neil and get more of a feeling as to how things are moving. Neil, it's interesting, looking at your most recent paper, you talk about significant distortions across all the asset classes. As a fund manager with this backdrop, how do you approach your job?
It'll sound glib, but the way we've always done, which is to look for good fundamental value, balance the risk versus the reward, and allocate our capital appropriately. QE has distorted asset classes, but as investors, we have to put that to one side and try and focus on the fundamentals.
Is there ever a time, do you think, in the cycle when you think, well, hang on, QE is going to be brought back at some point. They're talking about taper now, or certainly that's the implication. Is that a good time to exit or not?
I don't think it's necessarily a good time to exit the market, but we have to be cognizant that QE has had a significant impact. It's impacted market psychology. It's arguably one of the reasons why equity markets have been so strong. And there has been elements of mispricing. Now, I think that's most apparent in the bond market today. I certainly wouldn't want to be holding gilts at this point in time. But we've also seen, to my mind, an element of mispricing in those securities that are most sort of closely aligned to gilts, whether that's in forms of credit, but also in defensive-type stocks, consumer staples, whereby the whole purpose of QE is to force investors out along the risk spectrum. And one of the first stopping-off points in that is defensive stocks, consumer staples, those that have the most bond-like characteristics. And to our mind, those stocks have become fully valued. So over the last 6 to 9 months, we have been slowly exiting our defensive-type positions and reallocating that capital to more cyclical areas.
In terms of, before we get into more detail about those broad areas, in terms of where you are now as we go into the summer, which is very often a period where you either see wide swings or a dead market, how do you view the next 3 or 4 months? What do you think is going to happen over the summer as we approach that?
I think we're in for a period of reasonably high volatility. As you mentioned in your opening remarks, QE has distorted asset markets. The Fed has raised the dangerous topic of tapering. And equity markets, indeed all asset markets, operate at the margin. It's not necessarily the quantum of the change, it's the direction of that. And the Fed has let the genie out of the bottle. And it'll take a while for markets to find a new equilibrium. So we'd expect volatility to remain elevated for the majority of the summer. Equity, it's to have a period of consolidation, and what we still feel is a cyclical bull market.
In terms of some of the areas, we've been looking as well at the concerns a lot of investors have now about the commodities sector. Mm-hmm. How do you feel about that space?
I think it's important to ensure that there's a differentiation between commodities. Not all commodities are treated the same. We'd be more optimistic on the oil price, for instance. It's a very easy narrative at the moment surrounding the oil price, and that is that the impact of unconventional oil and gas in the US is going to lead to a supply glut, which will ultimately force the energy oil price lower. While that's an easy narrative, I don't think it's necessarily true. I don't think the US is about to export oil anytime soon. It's spent the last 30 to 40 years fighting numerous wars in the Middle East, all on the back of security of supply. Now that it potentially has that, I don't think it's going to export that quickly. And we've also still got considerable uncertainty in the Middle East around many producing nations. Will Iraq's infrastructure ever be back up and running again? Can Iran's infrastructure cope? Will Iranian sanctions persist? What will happen in Egypt? Indeed, what may ultimately happen in Saudi Arabia? And I think those are a number of factors why the oil price may well stay higher in the short term than the market believes. However, on the other hand, some of the base materials to us do look challenged. We still feel there's further downside revisions to China's GDP growth. We don't believe China will have a hard landing in the short term. That may be the long-term destination, but China's got enough levers to pull to avert that situation in the shorter term. But nonetheless, we're seeing increased supply of base metals at a time where demand is not growing as strongly as it once had. And it's a sad fact of life for many of the world's biggest mining companies that head grade at many of their mines is declining. They have simply produced the best stuff. And going forward, it's going to cost them more to produce the same amount. And that's not a particularly attractive mix for equity investors.
What about the precious metals end of the market? Where do you sit with where gold and silver are going? Because you speak to some people, they say they cannot believe it's gone as low as it has. Mm-hmm. And others are saying it's still got more downside to go.
I think perhaps you've got to differentiate the short term from the long term. I think there's every likelihood in the short term that gold and silver could have a bounce, just given the magnitude of the sell-off we've seen. But longer term, I'd be pretty bearish on the outlook for gold and silver. Gold has no intrinsic value as such. It's only worth what somebody else is prepared to pay for it. And in a global economy that's continuing to improve, as we believe it is, gold loses some of its attraction in that environment. And with a wealth of potential sellers, sentiment low and no intrinsic value, the price could overshoot to the downside. I mean, very simplistically, if we think about the investment universe as a whole as being a more normalised environment, whatever that means, but perhaps going back to somewhere approaching sort of 2008 or before levels, if we went back to 2008, gold was at $800 an ounce. So at 1,200, there's still considerable downside. So I'd be very wary of gold at this point in time.
Just quickly going back to the major sector, you talked about defensive. Cyclical, I think, is where you hold most of the UK Opportunities Fund. Do you see that changing anytime soon? What would be the catalysts to perhaps maybe change the...
It would have to be either we became more concerned around the direction for markets, at which stage we'd be more likely to raise our cash position than invest in sort of classic defensive stocks, because our philosophy is that we don't have to be fully invested at any point in time.
Right.
We believe that we're here to make money for our investors, and if we can't find interesting investment opportunities, we'd rather wait till a better opportunity comes along. And we may well move out if we saw more other opportunities in a differing area. Mining, we are negative on at this point in time. That may not be the case forever. We're always looking around to see where opportunities may arise.
You talk about making money for investors. You beat the market, I think, over the last month or so. That's right, isn't it?
Yes.
With that downturn, you've beaten the market. What's your recipe from this point, then, as a fund manager?
More of the same. We are bottom-up fundamental stock pickers. You invest in our funds. You are taking on a high degree of stock-specific risk. But if we get our analysis correct, then that will generate superior long-term returns. And our track record has demonstrated that. So we'll always look for the best upside relative to risk.
Okay, Neil, it's a pleasure. Thanks for dropping by.
Thank you very much.
Trip to London. Neil Veitch, he's the fund manager there at SVM Asset Management of the UK Opportunities Fund.